And then I went to the DH so much, the juvenile jail. I got sent to juvenile prison. I was supposed to do 2 years, and I got let out, I think, like a year and a half. I got a little bit early. But I mean, like, not the detention home, to juvenile prison. I was put on parole when I got out. Robbed my own grandma's pizza shop. I was just as bad as you guys, right? So the one thing I want to say, maybe this will take us to the next step, is if you guys think out there that you get this bad on drugs and alcohol and the devil doesn't take you over and it doesn't have something to do with demon possession, you are real mistaken. Yeah. Number one,
that too.
Number one, it's Bible, straight Bible, correct?
Yeah. Devil possession is Bible. And that's another thing too. Am I interrupting you?
No. Well, the last thing I want to say, and then I'll shut up because I want to hear this from you both. So it got so bad one time that I actually was looking in the mirror. I never forget this, at my grandma's house. My grandpa had already passed away. And I was looking in the mirror, and it was the strangest thing because I knew without a shadow of a doubt something was looking back at me through me.
Sure.
You may think I'm crazy. That's
no,
fine.
Devils are real.
I love everybody, but I'm telling you the truth, and God knows it. Yeah. I knew something was looking back at me. And the bad thing was, one more thing is, I didn't care. I was so I didn't care. I wrecked a motorcycle real bad, went into the hospital, should have died, didn't, only broke a bone. My mom sent a preacher in there, and he said, boy, don't you know you would have went to hell? And I looked right at him and said, yeah, there's the door. Yeah. That's how bad I was. Yeah. And I knew I would have went to hell, and I didn't care. Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say that I wanted to back up for just a second and say this too. Like David said, we got to the point where, like, we went out of this prison. You know, we don't want to do this anymore. It's no fun, and you're just getting high because you have to be high. It's not bringing you the joy. It's not bringing you the peace, and you want out. You can tell you're in prison. You start feeling you're in prison. So you try to stop, and what you become right then is you're trying to be a recovering, this is an important point, a recovering addict or a drunk or whatever, and you're trying to go down that road, and you relapse. You step right back in because it has such power over you.
And just like you can't live for Christ on your own, because the Bible says you can't, because it's not I that live with Christ living me.
Right.
You can't quit being an addict on your own.
That's what I'm getting to.
You can trade vice for vice and
now,
whatever else.
Some people somehow can build up enough willpower that they withstand the devil is actually what happens, and they get the victory. But all of us, and I'm hoping there's a lot of drug addicts and alcoholics watching this, you know that most of us weren't going to get out. And how many friends do you have that, yeah, I went to rehab and I'm fine now, and stayed that way? Very few.
For the rest of their life. And
yeah.
And we're not knocking that. We support any way you want to get your life straight. If you can get off drugs and alcohol, we support you.
Yeah.
We'll pray for you.
Yeah.
Awesome. But as far as us three go, there was no doing it on our own.
Well,
we tried.
My friends are still doing it. Those that didn't come to Christ, I don't know any of them.
And
I cleaned up.
So you still have friends that are on drugs and alcohol.
Absolutely.
I still have friends that are on drugs and alcohol, and sadly, a bunch of them are dead from heroin and fentanyl overdoses.
Yes.
How about you?
They died. Yeah. Even
sure.
The people at work died from drugs.
Lately, recently.
Recently.
And I want to step into something you said. I backtracked because I wanted to talk about the recovering addict and the recovering addict. We've played that game. And I'm not saying it don't work for some. But I want to talk about what Frankie said for a minute. I had the same experience. At one point, I felt demons moving in me. I wasn't stoned and tripping on LSD or whatever. I literally felt it. Matter of fact, that day, I don't even know if I was high at all. I was probably going over to Rollins' house to get some. If I remember, that's where I was heading.
It's funny you say that, because I think the day I saw them looking back at me, I don't think I was on anything either.
No. Matter of fact, see, the devil plays I'm not here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I felt these demons. Matter of fact, I remember I was walking through my buddy's yard, and I was smiling. They were saying hi and everything. And suddenly I felt this moving. And I wanted to emphasize this, and you looking in the mirror and seeing that. Suddenly there became, if you're honest, those of you that are bound like this, there became an evilness to it. You know, and you know it leads to crime. You know it leads to sex outside of marriage, which is a sin against God. You know it leads to adultery, ends up ripping you off and making you homeless. Those are evils that Satan does, and he's destroying
lives
majorly now. When I was young, at least in our city,
I didn't see a whole lot of homeless and like the kind of drug addicts that I became and was homeless. No. But when I was young, I don't remember that.
No, and you know, we grew up like I said, in a country town, Ashland, Ohio.
Yeah,
that's why we didn't get popped, because you hardly ever seen cops, you know.
How about you? I mean, did you ever have any experiences where you actually felt the stuff inside you?
No, not like how.
I mean, everybody is different.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Also, it's worth pointing out that.
But I want us to all three.
I was more excessive than David because of my personality.
Oh, you were?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I was really looking for Jesus. I mean, I really felt this emptiness.
You're more excessive than he is?
Yeah.
He was the ringleader.
I was the ringleader.
Well, I meant now.
Yeah,
but
I was
the
ringleader.
Mm-hmm. And I went along with the flow.
He went with the flow. I created the flow.
Yeah, he led the flow.
The devil used me to create the flow.
Yeah.
Probably like
there were many devils.
Frankie probably did the same thing.
Oh, I was, yeah.
Yeah.
And Napoleon on a surfboard.
Right.
Yeah.
And what that is you become the devil's spokesperson.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Unfortunately,
needs that.
Yeah.
He needs that.
And, yep. But so since I went more hog wild into it, I had experiences like that more than one. I had one time when I was playing guitar, lead guitar. I was a heavy metal lead guitarist, was really into, you know, I was into all those groups that were helping take me to hell, Zeppelin and AC/DC and all these wicked, wicked groups. You say, oh, they're not wicked. I love them. Well, you need to meet Jesus. It's a little bit different when you meet Jesus. And trust me, music was my God. Oh, I loved music. It was my God.
It was mine too. I was big into it.
I was a musician. Dude was born to be a musician. God marked me to be a musician. Started around the age of seven, like I said.
He did.
And
both of you.
So I was obsessed with music. It was my God. But the thing is all the people that went down that road with me and went into the rock and roll stuff, they end up getting just as bound as I was just from getting involved in that environment. It was just dark, 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 dark time for me.
Looking back, I actually met basically my idol who was on my bedroom walls. A real famous dude in a real famous band. They still are together to this day, and I just thought it was so cool. And just what a ripoff it all is.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't there a scripture that tells us there's pleasure in sin for a season, David?
Yeah, and I started to tell you, I got sidetracked.
But the end thereof is what? What's it say?
Death. And I started to tell you, but I got sidetracked there, that I had an experience when I was playing guitar one time. I was playing heavy metal lead guitar, and man, I could feel the demons flowing through me, and this darkness came bubbling up through my playing. And actually, I was totally taken over and was really jamming really, really good, and there was this puke from hell that was flowing through the music. Now, I was a sinner. When you're a sinner, you try to block those things out and not think about them, you know?
Oh, yeah.
The morals.
Oh, yeah.
And things like that. So now we're at the point we're talking about that we're bound. Did you try to stop?
By the way, one last thing. So I got so bad with all the drugs and the drinking. I'm maybe up into my early 20s. I had 3 DUIs before I was 25. 3. Now, this is years ago. I'm 52. It was before they really cracked down on them, because I only lost my license for like 3 years on the third one. Now you'd lose it for probably 20 or something. But 3 DUIs. And yeah, I felt bad and tried, you know, to be honest with you, I don't know that I really tried to stop.
Really?
Because you got to understand, I was driven by a different thing.
Didn't you want out, though? You didn't even want out?
At the very end, when I got delivered, I did. But I was mad at God. You have to understand, I had a different mindset.
Yeah, you were destroyed by it yet.
I was driving down the road one time. I know exactly where I was in Akron, and I had a Trans Am with T-Tops, and I had this stupid song on that was cursing God. The song was cursing, and I was screaming it with it. And I remember this. I actually looked up, and I screamed some bad stuff at God. Now, listen. I was getting on the highway while I did it on an on-ramp, and as I'm screaming at God, I hear, and I look, and I swerved over, almost got creamed by a semi, as I'm literally cussing God out.
Now, this is before you got saved, right?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I mean, I knew you weren't saved. I wasn't saved.
Yeah,
you
no.
That would have been your last words,
but
right?
I'm just trying to say, like, you guys were miserable. And, I mean, I knew I was, but it was just a different thing driving my rebellion.
Yeah, and it probably was because of the way you was raised.
Yeah.
But for me, and probably David, too, it just... You know, it's like, it's probably like being married to somebody and you're really not love, and you married just for lust only and you're not love. And then later on, you realize
you're just miserable.
I can't stand this person.
Yeah.
I, you know, get involved with them only because you wanted to have sex with them. It was kind of like drugs did that to me. It came to the point where, like, I didn't like it. It didn't bring me peace. And I remember one time, my buddy Kevin Kiplinger, and I hope he's watching this now.
Hi, Kevin.
I love Kevin so much. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Kevin.
I hope he's watching.
God bless you.
But me and Kevin, and I brought this up to him. I seen him not that long ago, and he's still partying. And I said, Kevin, do you remember that time me and you started just bawling and crying? Because we said, something's missing inside. He goes, I remember that. This one that long ago, maybe a year ago or so, I talked to him.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, we were bawling and crying, sitting someplace on a step or something. I can still see it, kind of. And I remember speaking up and said, Kevin, something's missing in our life. Something's missing. And the Lord was moving in on me. Hallelujah. So the bottom line is, none of us could get free. Is that correct?
Yeah. How about you? You feel a lot of conviction? Was God dealing with you that way, kind of drawing you out
I didn't
in
know
your misery? I feel like we're doing all the talking, David.
Well, no. Just to refresh and go back, I guess, down that kind of memory lane and hear you guys talk about this, I realized the truth that if it wouldn't have destroyed us to come to an end, we it would have killed us. We would have died in our sins.
Well, yeah.
We would have been lost. We would have been like, yeah. You know. So thank God that, you know, in a way it was allowed to destroy us.
No, yeah.
To reach us as part of his plan. Oh, you know what I mean? Don't forget that part. And that kind of came to my mind that, you know, if God wouldn't have allowed it to destroy us, when it came to an end, it would come to our end, it would have killed us.
And it wasn't, you know, I'm just
like, no, I agree with you.
You know what I mean?
I totally agree with you.
So I was looking at that phase of it, too.
And I'm going to insert this in. It wasn't just drugs and alcohol. I started getting involved in witchcraft and some different things. So I was intensely, I didn't consider it witchcraft, but it was transcendental meditation, which is absolutely a form of witchcraft. It's straight from Lucifer. But I was searching so hard for something to fill that. But the point I just really wanted to emphasize is that we couldn't get free on our own. We could not get. We reached a point where it was, for me, and for, I believe, most drug addicts, they all come to this point where it's no longer an option. Maybe you didn't want to be free, but if you would have wanted to, it wouldn't have been an option.
No. And I understand. Listen, make no mistake about it. If I would have tried to quit, I wouldn't have been able to.
Right.
Okay, I know that. And I agree with you.
Yeah.
It's just a really strange, I'm kind of like an asterisk there because
and everybody's different.
What got me was God straight dealt with me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I knew I'd go to hell. And then.
Yeah, now let's talk about that. We're doing pretty good. We got about 15 minutes.
Yeah.
So let's talk about.
This will definitely have to be
free.
This will definitely have to be carried over. This is probably the most important one. Well, not the most important, but it's definitely important. And people ask for it, and
so
people got to know.
Yes. Now I didn't know
that they can be free.
I didn't know that I could be free. I didn't really know that Jesus would set you free or anything like that.
You just knew something was missing.
Well, I'd never seen anybody. Delivered of drugs and alcohol. Now, I probably had heard of people that were what you would call recovering addicts and that were, you know, trying to stay sober.
Now, looking forward towards deliverance, you're both about the same thing, right? I mean, you didn't know Jesus could set you free, did you, at this point?
Well, yeah, I did. I didn't see no examples either. Nobody preached that.
Right.
Nobody, you know.
It wasn't in the forefront of my mind that, if I get God, Jesus will set me free. That's what I'm saying.
No,
you
know
what
I
mean?
Yeah, I knew. No, I knew enough that, you know, that he could.
And we all three knew enough we were living wrong, and if we died, we'd go to hell. Correct?
Yes.
And I also knew that if you were a Christian, you didn't do that stuff.
And I knew that, too, and you knew that, too, right?
Oh, it destroyed your life. It destroyed my life. I wouldn't want to do that.
I knew it was by the time
I wanted out. I wanted out of it.
I wanted out. And by the time I got to that point, I knew it was from hell and it was from the devil. I mean, I'd already, it had caused me to do crimes. It caused me to be with chicks. It had caused me to.
We were in a street gang for a while.
Yeah, experiment with a street gang. And it caused us to do things that we wouldn't have done. So we knew it was evil. We come to the terms that this was evil. But I just didn't see it. I never heard anybody say, hey, look, Jesus will set you free in a moment. You won't even be a recovering addict.
No, right. That was never presented. No.
Right.
We didn't know anybody.
And most of the churches today, this has to be said, they're teaching that, you know, hey, Christian, hey, addict, drug addict, come over here, pray this prayer, give your life to Jesus, and he'll give you the strength. He'll help you not to take it anymore. You'll always have that disease.
Well, they may not come out and say that, but their actions say it, even though their mouths don't. He'll forgive you of their sins, but
they say it.
Yeah.
Yeah. They believe that God will give you power to do the best you can, and it's going to be hard, it's going to be tough, and it's going to be a rough road.
And you're a work in progress.
You're a work in progress.
That's what they say.
And, you know, that I'll tell you right now.
Now we're about to get good.
Yeah. I'll tell you right now, that kind of gospel wouldn't have worked on this boy.
No.
Because
I tried that work in progress.
Yeah. And not only that, now look, when you're bound, here's what you got to understand. Even though we're saying that, okay, yeah, I want to be free. I don't like being in this prison. The truth of the matter is I was still yielding to it. So I kind of still wanted to do it. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
I was still, I wasn't every day saying, no, no, no. You know what I mean? I would go back to it. And do it. So what I'm saying is, it wouldn't have worked on me to say, hey, do you, if you want to be free, you know, I'll pray for you. And you got to have strength. The Lord's going to help you. And he's going to help you through this valley, buddy. You just got to decide you're not going to do it. Jesus is going to help you. I wouldn't have even done it.
You're talking about willpower now.
I am.
Right?
I'm talking about somebody presented me with, like, God's going to help you through it.
Yeah. Encouragement.
And it worked with me because, first of all, I didn't want to totally get out that much that I was going to ride this.
Ride the fence?
Yeah. And try to recover. I never would have tried to recover. I was too bound. And that's what happens with these people. They try and they go for so many months and the devil causes something many times to cause them to relapse or maybe they just give into it or whatever. But what it is they can't do it. They don't have the power. I certainly did not have the power to come out of the drugs and alcohol.
I didn't either.
No,
did you?
No, I had no power.
So let's say something. Hallelujah. We got a little bit of time left, and this is definitely going to be continued with all three of us.
You got to watch the next one.
Yes.
We're going to get into what happened.
Right, David?
That's right.
Yeah.
And but I want to say something before.
Pass the potato.
I want to just say this real quick. What we're going to talk about next week has nothing to do with being a recovering alcoholic or drug addict.
It has to do with being a new creature in Christ and all old things are passed away and everything has become new.
And delivering power of Jesus. Real power. Power more powerful than any drug I ever took. Hallelujah.
Amen.
For real. So, we have about like 10 minutes left, I think, right?
Mm-hmm.
So can I suggest something?
Yeah, we might reject it, but go ahead.
We don't have enough time to go into right when we all three got saved differently, delivered off of it.
We will.
So let's talk about one thing.
Yeah.
We know now, looking back, but even then, we already kind of touched on it. If we would have went into the church and they would have slowly tried to help us, there's no help. Now looking, I've visited a lot of other churches, and I've met good people, great people. But if I was to take someone like me now,
mm-hmm.
I don't know where I'd take him to get delivered.
You don't?
Well, I do.
Yeah.
But do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I guess, help me out here, guys. There's not a whole lot, at least where I've looked and talked and whatever, churches that teach, preach, or say, hey, oh, you're full of that? You want out? Come here. We're going to ask God to deliver you right now on the spot. And when is there a lot of that? That's what I'm trying to ask. Is there, David?
No.
We've been around.
But it's real.
No. I'm not saying it's not real.
I know you're not. I'm trying.
I'm trying to drive a point home.
Yeah.
It's as real as anything because you're looking at three examples.
Yes.
Period.
We were instantly set free. We'll talk about it next week.
We wanted a fourth one on here, and maybe she'll be on soon.
We wanted a fifth one on here, but he was like,
We wanted Jim's wife, Trisha. She's been delivered from drugs and alcohol, too. We have a really close friend who's been delivered from drugs and alcohol, but he didn't want to be on
camera. He wants to be behind
the scenes. We love you. Okay.
Yeah.
He's going to kill me.
Yeah, that's okay. He knows we love him.
Yeah.
But you
see the point I was trying to bring up is it's important for people if they hear this and they're like, oh, and God threw something in them, let's just put it out there like it is. Yeah. This isn't taught.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And you know,
you run around the city of Akron, hey, how do I get the devils out of me? Right. I know what I do and you know what you do. Right. But a lot of people be like, can you come back tomorrow? And they lock their doors.
Yeah. We're also going to have to discuss the point. No, you're right. We're also going to have to discuss the point that church might be the last place that somebody goes for that. God's people should be so full of God that they go out to them. Because they might not want to go to church or feel comfortable.
Jimmy, they don't have their waders on right now. You're getting really deep. But you're 1,000% correct. Yeah. Here's another thing, too. It's unfortunately grown so lopsided that when a person that's like maybe dirty, homeless, all jacked up, you know, they're on drugs or whatever, people aren't accepted anymore.
I know. They are.
They're just
Jesus.
Not accepted. They like, I hate to bring this up, but I seen a popular guy that I never knew even knew the Bible. This guy's known for doing drugs. He's an artist, a music artist. But he said, and I saw it. I sent it to you. He said, shouldn't that be the first place where everyone in the church would welcome that sinner down to the altar to get Jesus in him? Right. I couldn't believe it when I heard it from the person. I'm not going to say it, but
what would most churches do if somebody wants to walk in there in bare feet, dirty, maybe in ragged clothes, and come in there for deliverance? Most churches are going to either be scared of them or shun them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and this is why the people aren't being delivered. And the people don't have the love of God. It's because it takes the love of God to bring about the deliverance. Frankie, I think you're going to have to pray.
And make no mistake about it, everybody. We were all three bound by the devil on drugs and alcohol. We were all three set free through the blood of Jesus.
Instantly.
Completely.
No withdrawals.
Yeah, no, I had one withdrawal symptom, did you?
No.
No desire.
But
no
I want to say, no we're desire. Bringing this again. Maybe I've said it four times. I want to say it a fifth. We're bringing this out of love because we want anyone else out there that needs help. I don't care if you're in Iowa or Russia or wherever you are.
Right.
People need to hear this and need to know that Jesus Christ can set you. Yeah, yes. There's hope for the hopeless. And Jesus can set you free as simple as I'm about to just say this prayer in a second. Like that. He can set you free, give you a new life.
And I'm going to take it a step further. Not only Jesus can, Jesus will.
Jesus will, if you'll let him. That's the only thing standing in your way.
You got to want it, though.
Because he said, be it unto you as your faith is.
And you got to want to let go.
Yeah, and you got to want to let go, right. Because we'll if you don't surrender.
No.
Okay.
He's not going to force you.
Are we out of time? We got time.
You got a couple minutes.
I should probably pray. What do we got? Okay, so this is going to be, obviously, the very next one will be the second of this.
We'll tell about our deliverance.
Yes.
Yeah. Exciting.
Right.
Deliverance, and that it's not a work in process, and that there's all three of us had and your wife too, no withdrawal symptoms. I mean, we were changed.
And
like
we're not
that.
The only ones.
Oh my God.
For
44
years, I've watched people be delivered and set free instantly. Mm-hmm. No withdrawals, no cravings, no desire.
Exactly.
And hopefully, maybe on the next podcast, we're going to have a way that you can, an easier way than the YouTube comments, that you can send us requests for podcasts.
Yeah.
And prayer and questions that we'll try to answer, but it's only straight out of here.
Yeah.
And even prayer requests.
And if you need to get to us, we need to come up with a way that you can get to us.
But I think the one way we're going to have, you can at least send us a message about anything you want and we'll get back to you.
Yeah. But okay? I'm saying if you want to get with us.
And get free.
And get free.
Yes.
That's what Jimmy's saying.
We're going to have to work out a way to do
that. And we will.
Because.
Right.
Because one of the main reasons he set us free was that we would go and help others get free.
Right.
That's right.
That's why God delivers.
Drug addicts and alcoholics. Oh, my God. That's why we do this. I mean,
yes.
I love bringing this deliverance to drug addicts and alcoholics because it's real and it works.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pray, Franklin.
Yes.
Lord, in the blood name of Jesus, we bring everyone watching, God, before you. Lord, we have such a passion for these people, God, because we were one of them, God, until you set us free. Lord, let everyone know how much you love them. You gave your son for them, God. And he was drugged through the streets, and he was murdered so that we could be set free. Soul, mind, body, there's not anything too strong that Jesus can't do or can't deliver or can't make completely new. God, help them to yield to you. Help them to feel your power. Help them to reach out to us if they want to be free, or reach out to you wherever they are, God, and give their life to you and surrender. We ask all these things in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I almost cried your microphone. Well, we'll see you next time on Word Talk. Don't miss it. It's going to be even better than this one.
Yeah.
And I'm Frankie Rendino. That's Jimmy Ray. That's David Ray. And the truth will set you free, because it did, all three of us.
Yes.
God bless you.
Hallelujah.